Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome for Head of Effectiveness at Adam and Eve DDB UK, Mr. Les Binet.
Thanks very much. There's a lot of you, aren't there? I'm Les, and I'm Head of Effectiveness at Adam and Eve DDB, which, for those of you who don't know, is a creative agency in London, and we like to think quite a good one. For the last 10 years, I've been working with this body, the IPA, which is the body which represents the advertising industry in London, and I've been trying to understand how advertising works, how to make it work better, and how to measure it. That's really what my job has been for the last 10 years or so. And I've been able to do that really because I've had access to this tremendous resource that the IPA has built up, which is their effectiveness data bank. It's a massive database with information on over 1,500 advertising and marketing campaigns, with detailed information about what the strategy was, what the creative was, what the media used were, but crucially, what the business results were. And by analysing this data, Peter Field and I have been able to tackle questions like these. What are the ingredients for effective advertising? What works and what doesn't? What sells stuff? What makes money for clients and businesses? That's what we care about. What makes money? What sells? And over the last few years, we've published 4 books on the subject. The 2 most recent books focus in on whether the rules are different in our digital world, are the rules changing, and how do you need to adapt those rules to different brands in different situations. Now, there's a lot of stuff there, but I'm going to try and summarize it all in 10 key principles. And as you pointed out, the core principle I think that I think binds them all together to some extent is this idea of the importance of fame. And that's something that brands can use to turbocharge their business performance. So I'm going to start off with the first principle, which is about really the one that underlies all of them, which is about the difference between short and long-term effectiveness. So there are really 2 very different ways in which you can use marketing to sell things and in which you can use advertising to promote things. The first is easy to understand, and that's the short-term selling job. And I think that's the job that most clients feel really comfortable with. It's the one that's most common and most easy to understand in the world of digital marketing. And that's the idea of what we call sales activation. What do I mean by that? Sales activation is any kind of marketing activity which is designed to get a response from people now or in the very near future, to get people to do something now or in the very near future. Ideally, to get them to buy now. Now, if you want to do that, if you want to get an immediate response from people, then there are some very clear rules. As we'll see, you need to be tightly targeted. You need to focus on the people most likely to respond right now. Focus on the people who are going to buy right now or very soon. You need to give them relevant information. You need to give them information that will close the deal, that will sell the product. You need to be persuasive, but you also need it to be responsive. You want to make it easy for people to buy. One-click ordering is the absolute ideal. And when you get this stuff right, you can get really big effects, really big surges in your sales. This is the world of direct response, performance marketing. It's the world of a lot of digital marketing. And as I said, if you get it right, you get these big dramatic, easy to see spikes in your sales. But there is a problem. And the problem is that when you turn it off, you get very fast decay. Sales plunge back down, and pretty soon, within hours, days, you're back to where you started. You've not got any growth. You've just got short-term sales, efficiently delivered, profitably delivered, but no growth. How do you generate growth? You generate growth by doing something very different. In order to generate growth, you've got to change people's minds. You've got to build memory structures. You've got to change people's preferences. You've got to change people's habits. And that's a much harder job. It takes time. It takes repeated exposure. It's a question of training and conditioning people to want your brands and your products and your to come to your company. And that is a hard job. So the short-term effects tend to be smaller. You'll see that the little steps that you get from the blue line are smaller, but they last longer. And because they last longer, they build over time. That's brand building. That's what brand building is. I think we sometimes do ourselves a disservice by saying that brand building is just about changing perceptions and awareness and brand image. It is, but actually it's about building long-term sustainable sales and long-term profit. What we find is that sales activation is efficient, but brand building is effective because it drives growth, and it's also much more profitable because it affects the price that people are willing to pay, and you'll see a bit more of that later on. That chart, some of you may have seen before, I show it a lot, it's a relatively famous chart, and it really summarizes almost everything we've written in one picture, really. There is another tension at the heart of this, and that's the fact that in the short term, activation is easy to see and dominates ineffectiveness. So over that short period there, activation drives most of the sales. But in the long term, it's actually brand building that has the really big effects. And by short term, I mean anything less than 6 months. By long term, I mean, say, a year or so. And there's a real problem there, that means that if you focus on short-term data, you'll end up doing short-term things, getting short-term effects, and not getting the growth and profit that you deserve. You need to do long-term evaluation, use long-term data, have a long-term perspective in order to see what really drives profit for your clients and your businesses and your brands. Short-termism is a real problem in our industry and our business. So, you need to balance short-term and long-term, and that's my first principle, and that's, if you like, the principle that underlies everything else that follows. So my second principle is think broad. We are too obsessed with targeting. Targeting increases efficiency, but effectiveness is mostly about scale and reach and breadth. If you want to do brand building, you need to talk to people not just when they want to buy, but before they come to buy. You need to start preparing them to buy your brand way before they even know they want it. If you're selling cars, you need to start preparing people to buy your brand several years before they come to buy a car. And that requires breadth. You can't target those people based on their behavior because they don't know themselves what they're going to buy in 2 years' time or 3 years' time or 4 years' time. So breadth is really important. A subset of this is the whole problem of penetration versus loyalty. People in marketing often think that the most efficient thing you can do is to go really narrow, to focus on your best and most loyal customers, and to try and get more business from them, to improve brand loyalty. That seems really efficient because it means focusing on a small target group who are really responsive to what you have to say. And the problem is, it's actually really ineffective and produces poor business results. I'm not the only person who says this. As you probably know, Byron Sharp and all the guys at Ehrenberg Bass, Jenny Romaniak, Rachel Kennedy, all those brilliant researchers will tell you that loyalty first strategies always underperform. And our data shows the same. If you've got a choice between focusing on your existing customers or focusing outwards on acquiring new customers, you'll always do better by focusing outwards on new customers. On every business metric, for every brand, in every situation, there are no exceptions. Loyalty is a real red herring in marketing. It's misleading. But actually, there's a third strategy which works even better than acquisition, and that is reach. The most effective campaigns talk to everyone who buys the category. If you're selling small cars, your job is to talk to anyone who might buy a small car in the next 2 or 3 years. If you're selling whiskey, your target market is anyone who might buy whiskey in the next 2 or 3 years. If you're selling hamburgers, your target market is anyone who might buy a hamburger in the next 2 or 3 years, which is probably most people who are not vegetarians. And if you've got veggie burgers, then the answer is probably most people. Reach is far more important than targeting. You need to go broad. Targeting matters when it comes to activation, because that's the area where you need to focus on people who are going to respond right now. But for brand building, it's about breadth and reach and scale. So you need to talk to a lot of people. And then the next thing is to think about what you want to do to those people. And actually, what most people in advertising think at that point is, well, our job is to persuade them, to convey some persuasive message, or maybe make them feel something. But actually, the most important job, first of all, is to make them think of your brand at all. The main reason, as Byron Sharp, who's much cleverer than I am, the main reason that people don't, as he says, the main reason that people don't buy brands is not that they consider them and reject them. It's just that they don't think of them at all. So your first job is to make sure that people are aware of your brand. That's obviously really important. People don't tend to trust brands that they've never heard of. They are much more likely to buy a brand if it's familiar. But that's just the first step. That's how you get people to passively accept a brand when it's sold to them. The next step is to move up the scale of mental availability to salience, so that they automatically think of your brand when they think of relevant category buying prompts. So if you're selling hamburgers, you want to make sure that your hamburgers are the first hamburgers that come to mind when people think of hamburgers. But you want to go further than that. You want to make sure that your hamburgers are the first things that people think of when they're hungry, when they're hungover, when they want a snack, when they want lunch, when they want to take their kids for a treat. Making sure your brand automatically comes to mind. But the top level, and this is the core of what I'm going to talk about today, is fame. When a brand is so big and so broad and so omnipresent and so much in people's minds that they can't help but think about it and talk about it and talk about the marketing and talk about the advertising and share the advertising, then things really catch fire. It's this kind of scale of mental availability is almost like temperature. You get hotter and hotter and hotter, and then there's a certain point where things catch fire, where suddenly the whole thing becomes self-sustaining, where brands become a thing that we all are promoting, where the whole public, everyone in society, becomes part of the sales force. And if you can get to that level of fame, then incredible things can happen. So that's It's a very hard thing to do, but if you want to be a really serious player in your market, you need to aim for fame, at least within your category, and ideally within society. Not everyone can do it, because it's a bit like saying you want to have a hit film or a number one hit record or best-selling book. Only a handful of people and a handful of brands can reach that level. But when you do, you get really big effects. Campaigns that deliberately try to make the brands famous are much more efficient in the way in which they convert budget and share of voice into growth and market share. They are about four times more efficient at selling stuff than other advertising. And brands that generate fame are much better at reducing price sensitivity and getting people to pay more for the brand. Basically, people will pay a lot more for the brands that everyone knows and loves. When you get to that top level of fame, you can command much higher prices. So that combination of scale and price and margins is incredibly profitable. So it's not surprising that fame campaigns produce the biggest improvements in company profits that we've seen. So what drives fame? Well, unfortunately, there is no simple recipe for it. Partly it's about scale, partly it's about things like shareability, partly it's about tapping into the concerns that real people have in their lives. Ordinary people don't care about brands. Ordinary people don't really care about advertising and marketing. We do, but ordinary people don't. So you have to tap into the things that people really love, like music and art and kids and animals and other stuff like humor, sex. And you need to do something that is surprising. And this is why there's no formula for it in a way. Because what is surprising is generally something that nobody's done before. This is why creativity matters. There are many ways to be surprising. You can, one of the rules, if you like, is to break the rules, to go against category conventions. Great creative work really helps. Sometimes celebrities can borrow fame from celebrities, but often it works best if you use celebrities in ways that are surprising, ways that look quite different from the ways you've normally seen celebrities being used. One that immediately comes to mind, for example, is the Snickers campaign with Rowan Atkinson, which you may have seen, where you know, Mr. Bean, the character who played Mr. Bean, but being used in a martial arts film, a completely different way from the way he might normally be used. Humor, there's a lot of talk at the moment about using brand purpose and moral causes as a way of getting fame. You have to be quite careful about that, and I think we might be reaching a point where that's been used so much it's no longer surprising. Breaking the rules of media use sometimes. I think it'd be very interesting. Malcolm in a bit is going to talk about challenger brands and how they use media. I suspect there may be some of that in there. If you get this right, you can get tremendous amplification. You can make your media budget go a lot further. What we find is that owned and earned media can play a really important part here. So if you have your own media that you own, fame can get people coming to your website, coming to your video channel, coming and seeking your advertising out. And that's a tremendously powerful thing. It can increase the effectiveness of your campaign by 13% on average, measured across a range of different business metrics. And if you can get people sharing your advertising and talking about your advertising, the effects are even bigger. You can get a 26% uplift in effectiveness merely through word of mouth and online sharing. Don't neglect real word of mouth, by the way. Most of the sharing that happens and the buzz and the earned media is actually real people talking to one another in the real world, in bars and restaurants and cafes and in the workplace. Online sharing is actually only about 15 to 20% of the sharing that takes place. That's when you, when you've got real fame, you've got real people talking to one another face to face. But you can't do that just virally. Everybody thinks that, you know, we don't want to spend money on media. We just want to kind of go viral. We want to create something and let it fly out there. Well, we've looked at the data on this. Within our data bank, we find that people who try to, the strategy of just going, we'll put something on our owned media and we'll let it propagate virally, they fail 93% of the time. This is the rate at which they get significant amounts of earned media. Only 7% of them actually go viral. The rest fail. And then people who go, right, well, I'll tell you what, what we're going to do is we're going to have an advertising campaign and then we'll let people just sort of, you know, talk about it and propagate it. They fail 89% of the time. The only combination that works really well is you create great stuff, you put it out there in a place where it's easy to people to find, and then you spend a lot of money promoting it in paid media. It costs money to reliably go viral. But when you get it right, you can get some big effects, as you'll see in a minute. So there's no free lunch, unfortunately. So that's the first job. We are the mostly in the world of advertising and marketing. We're mostly in the business of fame and publicity. We like to think of ourselves as being communicators, but actually mostly what we are is noise makers. But once you've got your brand out there and you've got people thinking about your brand and talking about the brand, you obviously want people to think, not just think of your brand, but think something about your brand. So this is where we obviously think about marketing messages. And we often talk about getting our message out there and about communicating our message and making our message clear. And there is a role for that, but actually it's quite small. It's mostly in the world of activation. So if you want to get those short-term activation effects, it's really important to have a clear and persuasive message. And in fact, the more you move away from emotional flim-flam, as we would say in English, emotional fluffy nonsense and entertaining creative work, the more you move away from that emotional stuff to stuff that's more functional and rational and useful for people, the bigger the short-term activation effects. Activation is mostly about actually being useful. It's about giving the people the information they need to make the final decision to buy. Where do I buy it? How much does it cost? Is it the right size? That kind of stuff. But that's actually the only area of marketing where being rational and focusing on messages really works. Most of marketing is about brand building, and brand building is mostly about feelings and emotions and associations. In brand building, the more you move away from telling people things to making people feel things, the bigger the effects. In a way, brand building is not really communication at all. Brand building can be thought of more as conditioning and training people to feel something and prefer your brand in a certain way. And brand building is most of what we do. So really, we're not, most people in marketing are not communicators at all. Mostly what they're here to do is to make noise and create emotion. In a way, you might also, if you want to be really hard about it, and this is not a nice thing to say, you might say that we are in the business of conditioning the herd of animals out there. It's about animal responses. It's about herd responses. And there's a small role for rational communication. And I don't think that's particularly evil, because I think actually this is the way human beings are. We are all animals, and we are all primarily governed by feelings and emotions and responses that have built up over millions of years. There is a bit of an irony that I'm telling you all this. I talked about noisemakers, didn't I? There's an irony that I talked about this, I'm talking about this, and I'm trying to convince you with bar charts, Whereas, in fact, really what I should be doing is conditioning you emotionally. I'll do that in a minute. If you want to create those emotional responses, that the emotional responses that build brands and that ultimately drive growth and profit, you've got to be creative. If you want fame, you've got to be creative. Creativity tends to produce a stronger emotional response than mere rational communication. What we find is that ads that win creative awards tend to work more down the emotional route. They're more likely to get an emotional response from people. You know, nobody cried at a really useful piece of direct mail or a price promotion. Maybe they might cry if they got too many of them. But I have seen people cry at really great ads. And nobody goes to the bar and says, have you seen that fantastic 2-for-1 offer that I just received by email amongst the other 400 2-for-1 offers from competing brands? The response mechanism was really amazing. No, people talk about, have you seen that ad with the penguin in it? Creativity produces a better emotional response. It gets people talking. And creative award winners are mostly very much more efficient at selling stuff, often on smaller budgets, in fact. Now, I think Malcolm's going to probably touch on this as well later on, because my colleague Peter Field has been looking at this whole issue again, and I think there are problems in the world of creativity because we're beginning to misuse it. But creativity is still a tremendous power for selling and making money and for influencing people if you use it in the right way. So don't underestimate the power of creativity, but also don't underestimate the importance of budget. It's not enough just to have a great ad. You've also got to spend enough to make sure that everyone sees it, and everyone sees it often enough to create those massive fame effects that we talked about. Fame is very hard to achieve unless you put enough money into it. There is a rule that helps you to understand how much to spend. It's the share of voice rule. So what we find is that if you look at a brand's share of market, and if you look at its share of voice, so share of market in terms of share of sales, share of voice in terms of share of media spend, then brands that set their share of voice above their share of market tend to grow over the next 2 years, all other factors being equal. And that brands that set their share of voice below their share of market tend to lose market share over the next couple of years, all other factors being equal. Brands that sit on that 45-degree line tend to be, broadly speaking, stable. And that the rate of growth or decline tends to be proportional to what we call the extra share of voice, which is the gap between share of voice and share of market. You can use this rule, I mean, it's very boring and technical, but you can use this rule to estimate how much money you should spend to hit your targets. And guys like Malcolm at PhD have got a rather nice system which can help you do that. I'm selling your stuff for you. Malcolm doesn't need to turn up later on. It can be done. The interesting thing is that we've been looking at this rule over time. We keep expecting it to break down because, you know, there's all these changes in the media marketplace and the world is very different from the way it was 20 years ago. The interesting thing is that the relationship between share of voice, share of market and growth seems to be almost exactly the same now as it was 40 years ago, which I find remarkable. It may well break down, but it hasn't broken down yet. So you need to spend money, you need to spend more than your competitors, you need to punch above your weight. But the other rule that we've added to this rule is about how you balance the budget and split the budget between brand and activation. We call this the 60-40 rule, because what we find is that if you look at the effectiveness of a campaign measured across a range of different measures, sales, market share, profit, price sensitivity, and so on. If you look at the effectiveness of a campaign versus the proportion of the budget that is devoted to activation and the proportion of the budget that is devoted to brand, the short-term, long-term balance, then you see that there's a sort of sweet spot with about 60% of the budget on brand and about 40% on activation. 60-40 maximizes effectiveness, maximizes sales, maximizes profit, on average, across all product categories. Now, in fact, what the new work that we've been doing in the last couple of years shows is that that rule is different for different brands in different situations. So we call it the 60-40 rule, but it's not always precisely 60-40. So you need to understand how to tweak that rule, to adjust that rule to suit your brand in your category at your stage of development and so on. And in fact, the last book that we wrote, which is called Effectiveness in Context, is all about that, really. It's about how to adjust the rules for different marketing contexts. So obviously, buy the book. Little bit of activation there in the middle. Rule 9, you need to understand how to use media to do those two jobs, to do brand building and activation. Activation, as I said earlier, is about being tightly targeted on people who want to, are likely to respond now, giving them information and persuasive messages which will enable them to respond and buy, and making it easy for them to respond and buy. So the ideal would be one-click ordering, you know. Or I love the fact that Coca-Cola always wants to be an arm's length away. That's the ideal, is you want to make it really, really easy for people to buy the brands they want right now. But brand building requires broad reach. You need to talk to people long before they even know they want to buy. And that means talking to them when they're not interested. And that means using emotion, using creativity, using its charm and seduction. And it's about creating stuff that people want to watch and that will, that people will actually seek out. When we do our job well, we create ads and marketing that people actually enjoy. And I think that's really, really important. And that people remember, because then they must remember it, because this stuff's got to work not just now, but next week, next month, next year, in 2 years' time. Really great ads are seen by everyone, loved by everyone, and remembered for years. And that stuff really, really sells. And what we find is text is good, pictures are better, moving pictures are even better, and moving pictures with music is a killer combination. Movies. Basically, it's Hollywood. Hollywood understood this in the 1920s. That's what really, really builds brands, and that's what really, really sells things long term. So video, whether it's online or offline, is what really does this job really, really well. I'm going to show you an example.
All my little plans and schemes, lost like some forgotten dream. Seems like all I really was doing was waiting for you. Just like little girls and boys playing with their little toys. Seems like all we really were doing was waiting for love. Don't need to be oh.
actually says it better than Heather. isn't that better than the bar charts? And it says it better than the bar charts in a way. So this is an ad for John Lewis, which is a British department store. And every year we do ads for them at Christmas time, which are about basically come to John Lewis because you can buy the perfect present for the one you love. But notice how we did it. There is no product in the ad. Well, I mean, there's a penguin. You can buy the penguin, but it's not an advert for penguins. There's no voiceover. There's no price offer. I don't think that ad would be a better ad if someone at the end said, and penguins are 2-for-1 on penguins. I don't think so, anyway. We basically gave them a Christmas present, the audience, of a lovely emotional story. And this stuff really works. So what we do is the British public have now come to expect these ads every Christmas. They look out for them. They actually want to see them. And at 7:30 in the morning on the first day of the campaign, everyone knows it's coming and it's released online, and people surge to be the first people to see it online. I've actually seen this happening in real life. This is a true story, and it's kind of like, it's one of those stories that's too good to be true, but it is true. I was taking my daughter to school on the first morning of the campaign. We got to the railway station early, and there was only one person on the platform, a woman who's crying into her mobile phone. And I thought to myself, oh, is she okay? And I went up to see what was wrong, and she went, yeah, they've done it again. They've knocked it out of the park. It's amazing, the new John Lewis ad. And she's literally, it was like 7:32, she'd gone online at 7:30, watched the ad, and was now phoning all her friends to tell them, because she was the first person in her group who'd seen the ads. And I hadn't actually seen the ads at that point, because I'd been away at a conference like this the night before when we do the big reveal. We keep them very secret. So I sat with me, my daughter, and her, and we watched the ad together on the phone on a semi-deserted railway station. And she was literally crying. That's what really great adverts do, and that's how you get fame. And look at the online views. This is 64 million views, mostly in the UK, for an ad for a little department store, you know? That's a lot of views, 64 million. I mean, that's, if you replicated that globally, that's like Gangnam Style. It's massive, but it's just mostly in the UK. I mean, we are a population of 62 million, you know? Everyone sees these ads and watches them multiple times. That's how we start the campaign at 7:30 a.m. In the evening, it goes on television. And it's such an event that actually the TV companies actually tell people which break it's going to be in. Okay? So people tune in on the TV to watch the fucking ad, which I think is mad. That's what the TV views are. 791 million views over the course of 6 weeks on TV. And that puts online views into perspective. This is not actually an unusual number. We have to understand that in the world of marketing, a million is a small number. If you want to sell stuff in a country like ours of 62 million people, then anything under 10 million exposures is small. Getting up to 64 million is decent, but if you want real fame and real sales and real profits, you need to talk about hundreds of millions. And that can, at the moment, only be delivered through the combination of online media and traditional media working together. And that's what really smart marketers do these days. Online video and TV. Online audio and radio. Use all the tools working together. TV is not dead, it still has a massive part to play. And I'm not the only person who thinks this. It's really interesting, if you look at what the tech firms, the challengers, the disruptors are doing, companies like Uber and Netflix and Microsoft and Google and Facebook and eBay and Apple and Amazon, they are piling money into traditional offline media. Uber came to London at first and they didn't do any advertising at all, apart from promotions. Now Uber use cinema, they use radio, they use posters, they use press, they use TV. Netflix, massive spend on posters in the UK. Microsoft have been using traditional media for years. Google, I mean, Google know a thing or two about how advertising works. They've got data. I don't know if you know that, but Google have some data. When they launched their Pixel phone, they used posters. Facebook have started using TV advertising in the UK, as well as press and posters. When Facebook launched the Facebook Live feature in London, this is launching a new feature on their service to their existing Facebook users, you might have thought they would use Facebook. They use ads on bus shelters. And Amazon, last Christmas, you could not move for Amazon ads in cinema and on TV and other traditional media. In the UK, I only know about the data for the UK. I'm sorry, I don't know about your market. But in the UK, the biggest Christmas advertiser on TV was Procter & Gamble, who have, I think it's fair to say, several brands. The second biggest TV advertiser was Amazon. Amazon spent £45 million on TV advertising in the UK last year. Jeff Bezos has completely turned around and says he's fallen in love with TV advertising. So don't let people tell you that traditional media are dead. The only people who think that are the stodgy old FMCG firms who are trying to be like Amazon and Apple were 20 years ago. Smart marketers know that the best comes from the combination of the old and the new. So hopefully that's given you some broad principles for maximizing the effectiveness of your campaign. Some of you are photographing the screen. I'm not going to go back through them because there's another principle which I think is perhaps even more important than that, which is read the book. It's all in there. This is a very boring book full of graphs, for those of you who like my boring graphs. For those of you who prefer stories and anecdotes, then I have another book called How Not to Plan, 66 Ways to Screw It Up, which is mostly funny stories. It's all about the fuck-ups in marketing and all the many ways that agencies and clients and businesses get it wrong and what you can learn from that. So with the boring graphs and the funny stories, hopefully you'll have one or two things that can help you to produce better advertising, better marketing, get more growth, and make more money. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And now for some questions. And the first question for you, submitted by the audience, is can you give an example of a brand that has truly gotten the fame thing right? But I think that's John Lewis, isn't it?
Yeah, it's John Lewis, yeah. I mean, we're not the only one. And it will be different in different markets. In Britain, I think it's fair to say that the John Lewis ads are the most famous ads in the country. In the US, of course, you have the Super Bowl, which is really a fame competition, isn't it? The Christmas ad campaigns are the UK equivalent of the Super Bowl. I don't know what it would be here. It varies from one market to another. And of course, there are certain brands that are just famous in their own right, like Apple and Nike and Google and so on, over and above their advertising.
All right. The next question from Alvina. Do you use, where is it here? Do you use neuromarketing studies or only use insights from traditional marketing research?
Neuromarketing is a very vague term, really. I mean, on the one hand, you might mean putting people into brain scanners and looking at, you know, the electrical activity in the brain. I'm actually quite skeptical about that. I am a big believer in understanding the human psychology. So we had an initiative where we have a psychologist come and sitting and working in the local DDB agency, a scientist in residence, as we call him. But brain scanning is only a small part of what psychologists do. There's a brilliant study where some of these people that we worked with, what they did was they took a dead salmon, a fish, and they hooked it up to a neuroscanner, a brain scanner, and then they showed it ads, and they got a statistically significant increase in brain activity in a dead fish. And that tells you something about brain scanning, I think.
All right. What to do if your brand is not big enough to be able to buy a lot of reach? Well, that's the situation we live in here.
Okay, so small brands come in two flavors. First of all, there are little startups, and Malcolm's going to talk about that, I think, a bit. If you are a little startup that's got a radically new product that's just, you know, disrupting things, actually, I think you can, in the early days, get good growth through simply great products, great prices, great service, making it available and growing organically. People in advertising agencies don't like to stress this because we're selling advertising. But you know, if I was running a small business, I'm not sure I would start with a brand campaign. But you get to a certain point where you then that won't take you any further, and that's when you need advertising. And it doesn't necessarily have to be the biggest campaign in the world. It's about how much you spend relative to your size. So brands can often start with very low budgets, but they need to gradually ramp them up as they grow. And what they need to do is to look bigger than they are all the way through the process. So it doesn't have to cost you 60 million quid, but you know, 60 million pounds, as I say. But but you need to punch above your weight, be bigger than you are, if you like, look bigger than you are.
Where do you see trends?
I am not, well, trends, so I'm not a planner, by the way. I'm an econometrician. I do statistical analysis, mathematical analysis, market mix modeling. I look at trends by looking at trends in data. I am not, many planners are just interested in trends, you know, kind of like what's fashionable, what's coming up, what's exciting, and a lot of that stuff I think is nonsense. So the trends I'm interested in are things like, you know, I'll tell you a piece of trend data I think which is really interesting is Google Trends. Hands up how many people here use the Google Trends data? Okay, you all should. Google Trends allows you to look at patterns in search behavior on a weekly basis all the way back to 2004 at your desktop for free. It's the most incredible source. And you can look at what people are searching on and what people are looking for in every country in the world, in every category, and you don't have to pay any money for it. That's a really interesting data set.
All right. Does aiming for fame work also in social campaigns, like promoting use of seatbelts?
Yes, it does. Social campaigns can be slightly different because it's one area where sometimes you can be negative, mostly when we're trying to use positive emotions, but you may want to, you know, you may want to make something socially unacceptable. And actually, if you can harness, I used the word contagion earlier on, if you can harness that for social campaigns, that actually can be the most powerful thing of all. Because, say, for example, you want to stop people using reusable, disposable cups, then actually the most powerful thing is if it's everyone around you is telling you that's unacceptable. Right. So actually fame is really important there.
Okay. You were talking a lot about you were talking a lot about the fame. Well, you were talking
about
fame. Yes. So is fame the same as top of mind and brand awareness?
No, it's not. No, that's like the difference between something being hot and something catching fire. You need very high top of mind awareness. That's salience, really. But fame is where you get to that point where it's gone beyond being private, where people are talking about stuff and where ordinary people are pushing it forward. So it's like the difference between, if you think about somebody who's famous, like Donald Trump. Okay, Donald Trump is famous, and that shows you also that fame can sometimes have a negative dimension for some people. You might always think of toilet roll when you go to the toilet. That's very high salience, but it's not fame. Fame is you don't talk about toilet roll in the pub, and you don't say, you know, this is really fantastic toilet roll that I used yesterday. Well, I mean, I do, obviously, but I'm unusual. So it's different.
All right, what do you think about do, if you know it?
Digital out of home, yeah.
Is it old or new media?
Why do we like to use acronyms like that? Why can't we, video posters or something like that? Do. I'm not a big fan of TLAs, three-letter acronyms. This is a four-letter acronym, so this is an FLA. Digital outdoor, is it old or new media? Clearly it's a bit of both, isn't it? And it's a new way of doing an old thing. It does have some interesting qualities. So digital outdoor, because you can have, moving pictures. You can have digital outdoor that's just static and is really just a way of delivering something that's kind of old. But also you can have moving pictures. And as I said, moving pictures have different effects on people to static pictures. Digital, when you've got video on posters, it's really hard to ignore. I don't know, have you got lots of digital outdoor here?
Not really.
Okay, well, we've got a lot in London. And so if you're traveling on the tube, sometimes, you'll be going up the escalators and there are digital posters all the way up the escalators. And I don't know about you, but I mean, I find that, it's like my head's doing that the whole time. It's very, very hard to ignore. And actually, that's both an opportunity and a problem, because it's a bit like poking people with a stick. poking people with a stick gets attention. But imagine that's happening as you walk around London every second of every day, there may be problems with that. We shouldn't care if it's old or new media in a way. Why are we so obsessed with the new? What we should care about is what works and how it works. Something's not good because it's new, and it's not bad because it's old. It's just different.
All right. Someone is really curious, what's your role at Adam and Eve?
Okay, so my day job is sort of measuring the effectiveness of our campaigns. So, with the John Lewis advertising, I don't know what the ads are going to be before they run. They're kept very secret, even though I work with people who do know. I have some input into things to do with the long-term strategy, but I don't see the creative work. But what I will then do is look at the results after they've run, and I'm part of the team that's helping to learn from that, and also then trying to feed that agency into the that learning into the wider agency. So I'll work with the planners, the strategists, to help to make sure that they are giving clients best advice, to try and make sure that our ads work as well as they possibly can, and that we can measure them properly. So I do that's my day job, is working with real campaigns, and then doing this sort of theory stuff on the side.
Okay, here you have another three letters. What is the best KPI? For brands.
So key performance indicator, which this little side issue is very few people know where that term comes from. It comes from one specific book by two people called Kaplan and Norton, called The Balanced Scorecard, which is all about balancing measurement techniques. And so the whole point of that fucking book is there is no best KPI. the point of the book is that you need a range of key performance indicators. They typically say about, I think, 24, thereabouts, that kind of order of magnitude, and that you need to have them in balance. It's a bit like saying, you're flying a plane, which is the one lever I should pull, or which is the one dial I should look at? You need to look at them all. Next question.
The next one is a love letter from the penguin, as you
I didn't cry.
But I wanted to tell you that John Lewis adverts actually are a big thing here as well. They always go viral, and songs are always on radio. So it's not just UK thing,
no.
as you painted it.
No, it actually
has international appeal.
Well, I think you probably guessed that by the fact that there were more views than there were people in the UK. So I didn't cry just now either, but I've seen it a few times as well. But I mean, it's amazing actually that I mean, I've seen these ads so many times, and occasionally the funny thing is, if I try and describe the ad to someone who hasn't seen it, I will often get goose pimples. It's actually happening right now to some extent. and I have seen people cry. I mean, hats off to the people who make them. They're amazing.
All right. How do you persuade clients to invest in emotion, brand, and projects when only thing they believe is sales campaign?
Yeah, well, it's all about selling. It is all about selling. The point is emotion sells stuff. I didn't tell you the killer fact about John Lewis. I should have done this. Those ads, we've measured the effect on sales and profit. Every pound they spend on, for example, the Penguin ad, generates £10 or over £10. I think for the Penguin one, it's £11 of extra profit. Not sales, but profit. It's an 11-to-1 profit ratio for that blooming Penguin.
it's better than betting. It's better than sports betting.
yes, I think it probably is. Yeah. Where are the books available? I like this question a lot.
Yeah, I know.
I didn't bring any with me because they're quite heavy. But they are on Amazon. And if you can't get them on Amazon in the Baltic, then you can go to the IPA website, which is www.ipa.co.uk. And the spotty book is through the APG, the account planning group. But I'm sure the organisers will help you to find them.
Yeah, our time has come to end. Sorry.
That's a good last question there.
Yeah.
It's not planted.
It was indeed. Please make a huge applause for Mr. Les Binet.
Thank you very much.